Hi, I'm Adam Culp, and you're at Beachcasts. Today we're going to talk about using data getters and setters in our application, and we're going to get right on that. Welcome back. If you want to learn more about programming, and more specifically, if you want to learn about web programming, make sure that you subscribe to the channel and also click the bell so that way you're notified and you don't miss a thing. And also remember to like the video by clicking the thumbs up button. Afterwards, make sure you go out to our website and sign up for the newsletter. We send out some different tips, different announcements, and things like that, not to mention notifications of videos that we've released in the previous month. And I promised I'm not going to spam you. It's just a monthly newsletter to keep you informed of what I'm doing here at Beachcasts. So as I said, today we're going to be talking about using getters and setters, also known as accessors, in our application. There are many, many thoughts and feelings on this. Of course, getters and setters are kind of problematic. They're not necessarily the best thing to use, but needless to say, there are some benefits to using them inside of our applications. So let's cover some of the things, some of the reasons why you might want to use getters and setters. First off, it gives you separation of concerns. With separation of concerns, you want to make sure that the consumer class doesn't really need to know everything about the primitive variable or whatever is being brought in. So the idea is that your consumer really should only know what it's actually calling and maybe how to use it after it gets what's being provided, but it doesn't really need to necessarily know exactly what is there. Another reason to use getters and setters is for code maintainability. Variables, if you left a variable out in the open being public inside your class, where meaning that it could be called statically or that it could be populated and have values passed into it, the thing is that you would also need to make sure that the data that you're passing in, number one, is being validated, is being properly escaped, and anything else that goes along with that. Maybe you want to make sure there's some different error checking and things like that to go along with the data prior to populating it inside of field of your class. Whereas on the other hand, if your application is not concerned with all of that, you want to make sure that the getters and setters are facilitating, right? So the getters and setters should perform some validation. The getters and setters should know what data it's going to be putting into the field. And if there's any error reporting that would happen with the data being put into the field, then that would also be handled by a getter or a setter or the object that the getter or setter is in. It really makes for a lot cleaner code if your getters and setters are there, because now you don't have to do all that within your application. Now, if you were doing that within your application instead of leveraging getters and setters, then you, like I said before, you have to worry about error reporting. You have to worry about validation of the data to make sure it's what's expected. You would also have to do a lot of other things with that data and manipulate it. Not to mention that in your application, if you're not using getters and setters, then that means that you also need to track the values of these variables. You have to track the values of the fields. So everywhere in your application that is using those variables, populating those variables or fields, anything that is using them and interacting with them, then you need to worry about having the plumbing code also everywhere throughout your application. And that can really lead to a lot more code, a lot of code repetition. And copy and pasting code from one place to another causes a lot of issues, because then you have to constantly keep track of things. Whereas if you're putting your management of those fields within your getters and setters, it's only in one place. All you're doing is calling the getter, calling the setter. It's taking care of everything and worrying about the maintenance of that field for you. Now, there's also another site out there that I found where it talked about the tell don't ask type of methodology, right? At Pragmatic Programmer, they talk about how you should tell an object to do things rather than asking a question about the object state, then making a decision, and then ultimately telling the object what to do. So if you're telling the object what to do from the very beginning, instead of worrying about asking a question, changing the state, understanding the state, making decisions based on the state, and then telling the object what to do anyway, it just makes sense to do that from the beginning. Not to mention that you should not be making decisions based on the state of a called object that results in changing the state of the object. This is the responsibility of the object to do that for you. This violates encapsulation of behavior if you're doing the behavior outside of the object. Not to mention the fact that that's very procedural, right? If you were to be calling data from the object and then making decisions and handling things, that's doing things in a very procedural way. Generally, we like to do things in a declarative way with object-oriented, and that's why, telling it instead of asking is a much better methodology to use. So classes should be based on their responsibility, with commands within the object to be able to execute and be able to handle that, instead of queries that inform on the state, right? So queries should not get information about the state of the object. They should only issue commands to act on the object. The other way, if you're actually dealing with the fields from outside of the class, you have data. Imagine if you had data like, for instance, red. Red is just a bit of data. It's a 3-character string, right? What do you do with that? What does the red do? And in your application, if you know the data like that, then, it's one thing to have the data, but where do you use it? How does it link up? Where is it connected? Whereas if your object has the color red, it knows that the red is associated to something within the object. So the data doesn't necessarily know what it relates to. It's just data. If we're managing that from within our app or from our application without getters and setters, then it's no longer associated. It is just data being thrown around the application. Not to mention that setters and getters also facilitate lazy loading. You're loading the object and then using the getters and setters as you need to. Alternatively, if you didn't have getters and setters, then you would have much extra code that is not lazy loaded, so to speak, and is strewn throughout the application to help manage these things. Another benefit of setters and getters is it controls the lifetime of memory management or the disposal of it, right? And the semantics of the property, because now you're getting and you're setting, but everything is maintained within the object versus the application. So it tends to be if the object is gone, then the data is gone. You're not having to worry about a lot of that. Getters and setters also help with debugging. They give you inception points. So where an object is in relation to the object, when you call the setter or call the getter, those are places that you could put breakpoints, for instance, to help with debugging. Getters and setters also help with interoperability between libraries, such as mocking and serialization and the things that have to happen in order for other libraries to use your code. In PHP, we have PSR7, and using getters and setters work really well with that because now the data is being managed through the objects versus the outlying application. Another benefit of setters and getters is that it allows for your overriding, right? So if you were extending a class, if you wanted to extend a class, then you could override the getters and setters from the external code if you needed to. I mean, the getters and setters should handle everything, but just in case you're using an object that you needed to use in a slightly different manner, or maybe you needed to add some additional validation or some additional manipulation of the data, you would be able to do that through extending the getters and setters. Not to mention that your getters and setters would also be able to be used as lambda expressions in the case of some of the newer design patterns being used with modern development. And you can also change the access levels of the methods to be set, you know, maybe you wanted to use a public getter, but yet a protected setter. So those are kind of some overarching points about getters and setters, the positive sides of using them. However, not everything is positive, right? There are some reasons why you might not want to use getters and setters. On the negative side, there are arguments that say using getters and setters expose implementation details. You know, if you follow most standards, your field is going to be named similar to your data structure, right? So if you have engine, for instance, in terms of a car, and you had get engine or set engine, developers could extrapolate that and know that the data structure now has an engine field or an engine data in the database, and be able to manipulate that or be able to use that in some way. Simply setting values without any change or validation would be one possible reason not to use setters and getters. If you simply need to set the data and get the data, and there's no manipulation happening, there's no validation, things like that, then it might be okay not to have a setter and getter for a specific field. Another time that you might not want to use setters and getters is in the case of public classes. If you have a publicly available class, then maybe you don't need setters and getters. Maybe make the fields in the class publicly available, because it's public in any way. However, if it's internal things or data points that you don't want people to be able to manipulate from extending applications or using, in the case of using a library, then you might not want to put that public, and you might want getters and setters for that, right? Because you want to protect that data. That's the reason behind making fields protected or private, and then putting getters and setters in the first place, is to ensure that nobody can get to those, nobody can touch them. Now, there are also some people lately that are looking at the next version of PHP, PHP 7.4, where we will have typed properties. And there are arguments being raised and saying, now that we have typed properties in PHP 7.4, maybe we don't need getters and setters. So there's another time that you might not want to getter and setter, is if you're using PHP 7.4 and you're typing your properties. Now, I would argue that just because you're able to type your properties, it doesn't really necessarily take care of validation or maybe some calculations or something like that. But that being said, that is one of the arguments out there recently, is people are like, yeah, we don't need setters and getters anymore because we're going to have type properties as of PHP 7.4. So how can we handle getters and setters? Well, if you watch one of my previous videos where I was creating an entity, in there I manually created the setters and getters and did a lot of typing. Actually, I think I copied and pasted, but I would have had to have typed beforehand and created those. However, there are automated ways to create getters and setters, and I'm going to show you those right now. So let me just do a little bit of moving around here. I'm going to then switch over to this view. All right, so now we can see here that I've got a class, right? I've got a class named announcement new. I've got some fields in here. I've got some protected fields, and those pretty much match my database. They pretty much match my data structure. So if I look in the data structure, I see I've got ID, sort, content, is active, created, and modified. And so that's my data structure. And I've got the class, so I can create the protected fields, and I want to create getters and setters for these. In this case, I've made them all protected. I don't really want anybody able to manipulate these externally. I want them to be handled by the application. So in PhpStorm, it has a neat way of doing that. I could either right-click and select generate, generate, and by selecting generate, then I can select whether to create getters, you know, and then I can select the fields, or I could have just as easy selected generate and setters. We can see I got setters here, or I can just go ahead and do setters and getters both all in one sweep. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm going to click getters and setters. Now here we see that I'm able to select these fields. Now in my case, I want to select them all because I want to create getters and setters for all of them. Now I might not need to keep them all, but I'm going to create them all initially and enable myself to be able to generate those. Now there's also a checkbox here for fluent setters, right? So what that's going to do when I check that is it would then return after the data was set, it would return the object as the result. So then I could get that back. Now I'm going to uncheck that because what I want to do is rather than returning the object, I don't want to return anything once I've set the data. Okay, so I've selected everything there. I could also down here select none if I wanted to, and it would basically do nothing. Let me go ahead and get back in there. Generate getters and setters. I'm going to select them all and select OK. And what it does is it manipulates the class. Now it went ahead in here. It created getters and setters for everything. We have get modified and set modified. And it created that for every field in that I had selected, right? So we have get ID, we have set ID. Now you'll notice that the setters, what I'm doing is I'm setting the field, this ID equal to ID, and of course it's expecting the argument to be passed in, and then it's returning void because I'm not returning anything here. Now again, if I had set it to be fluent, then it would have done something like, get a little bit slow. Then it would have done like a return this, right? But that's not what I did. I didn't select the fluid. So it's just returning the ID. So that is how you can automatically create the getters and setters from within PhpStorm. Other IDs have that available as well. Some editors have automatic getters and setter creation, but that's how you do it in PhpStorm. So I hope you found this useful. Again, if you want to know more about programming and specifically more about web programming, make sure to subscribe to the channel. And also click the bell so that way you're notified for any time we release a new video. And like the video and tell your friends. Thank you for coming.